Okay, so here we are on video number 3. And again, I don't want you to be concerned if you can't see all the words. It's really just kind of a guideline for me to keep me focused. You've got the PDF. The PDF is going to give you all that you need to know in terms of the format that I'm going over. And now that you have the format, and I've walked you through the format itself, the CUES evaluation template or kind of the framework for understanding CUES, now I'm going to go into some examples. And I referred to an example in the second video. We're going to dive into it a little bit more and actually kind of stick it through that CUES evaluation machine and start to apply all those different things that are in the evaluation process to the CUE. So the CUE I've got here is contract your glutes in bridge. So in bridge pose, let's say I had students coming into bridge and I said, hey, I want you to contract your gluteus maximus, right? So to be really specific, that's the one we're talking about versus glute medius or glute minimus. We're asking them to contract the gluteus maximus, which is on the back of the body. So the CUE, contract your glutes in bridge. So the first thing we have to look at, right, so we're just going to go through the process. If you've got the PDF printed out in front of you, you can see each individual criteria. The first thing is, what is the anatomical action? So the anatomical action in bridge is hip extension. Now, while there may be also a little bit of internal rotation and a bit of adduction, primarily we're looking at hip extension being one of the benefits and being the primary action in bridge. And then the next thing is, what are the muscles involved? So the muscles are part of the CUE itself, glutes, but I want you to remember that when I mentioned glutes, I made a distinction between glute max, glute med, and glute min. And I think that's really important because oftentimes you'll hear people say things in class like, hey, this is great for your glutes, but I bet if you ask that teacher, can you name the glutes and tell me the distinction between the three, they wouldn't be able to do that. Now, I'm not suggesting you do that, and I'm not trying to shame anybody, but I think this is, again, some of that kind of yoga speak that's out there when people just kind of refer to muscles without really knowing what the difference is. It's very similar to saying, this is really good for your rotator cuff, without having a good understanding of the four muscles of the rotator cuff, how they are different, which ones share anatomical actions, right? So it's all about saying things that are grounded in what you know versus just saying things for the heck of it. And maybe not even for the heck of it. You're saying things maybe in an attempt to be helpful, and yet if you don't know the why or the kind of the rationale or the detail behind it, it lacks a certain sense of kind of being helpful to your students because you couldn't really answer a question if they asked you, and it lacks a certain sense of being specifically helpful. So anatomical action, muscles involved, glute maximus, gluteus maximus on the back of the body. Next thing, joints involved. So the joints involved in bridge primarily are the hips. Certainly we could say the SI joint to a certain extent. We could even refer a little bit to the lumbar spine, even though we want the primary action to be hip extension. So that's kind of a good distinction to be able to understand how you would cue people to work more towards hip extension and less towards movement through their lumbar spine extension. And the next one, is it too specific or too general? So if I say to a group class, contract your glutes in bridge, is that really just focusing on a couple of people? Why am I asking them to do that, right? So as I come into bridge pose, just the mere action of coming into bridge is asking my glute max to contract. Contract here refers to concentric contraction, right? So I'm asking my muscle to do its job. And by lifting my hips up off the mat, I am coming into hip extension. Some muscle is concentrically contracting to do that. And in fact, the muscle is the gluteus maximus. So is it a bit of overkill to say contract, or is it that I want them to emphasize the contraction by maybe adding a little bit more emphasis to the action of contracting, right? So you might have a sense, and this is kind of going a little forward, I'm going a little ahead of myself here, but I'll just throw it in now. Let's say I was teaching a class in the late afternoon, and I pretty much assumed that most of the people in my class had been sitting all day. So they've been sitting all day on their gluteus maximus, their hips are in flexion, so the gluteus maximus is now not contracting, it's lengthening, but they're not actively doing it, they're passively doing it. So in that case, they're coming to class, they come into bridge, and I might want to have them add a little more emphasis to the anatomical action that is already happening. So I might ask them to contract their gluteus maximus a little bit more than is happening just naturally. I might even do it at the beginning of class as a way to wake up that posterior chain, right? So that is an illustration of really knowing the why behind the cue, because you literally take the posture from its normal place way down the sequence and you move it up to the front of the sequence because you understand why you're gonna give them the cue you're gonna give them, and you know that they've probably been sitting all day. Why don't I kind of give those muscles that have been passively lengthening a little bit more of a work effort here to kind of give the body kind of more overall tone and awareness. So that is kind of the perfect blend of the knowing and how it can really inform you as a teacher and give you the freedom to make decisions on the fly. And then if someone were to come up to you after class and say, hey, we usually do bridge later in the sequence, why did you put it at the beginning? You would have, you know, again, remember that machine, you would have a rationale that you could share with the student and then get into a really good dialogue about the muscle, its anatomical action. That's how that impact piece comes into play that I talked about in video one. So we've looked at anatomical action, muscles involved, joints involved, too specific, too general. So now static or dynamic. So we're coming into bridge. Bridge is not a dynamic pose. We're not having them do a variation where they're moving their hips. We're just asking them to come into the posture. So it's a static posture. So to a certain extent, there's a little less risk there. It just gives them a little more time to focus on what you want them to do. And then the last thing is frequency. Is bridge a pose that you do a lot? If so, that would have implications for definitely knowing the why behind the cue. I would say in general, we probably do bridge, I put here 3 to 4 times a class. So the risk isn't generally high. The posture itself is fairly stable, fairly accessible for people. So that's just another factor. So at the end of the day, when you analyze this cue, contract your glutes and bridge, you've been able to break it down among all these different factors. And my suggestion, right here I have bottom line, must include the why to effectively teach and add value. In other words, if you're going to say to people, contract your glutes and bridge, you really should include why you're asking them to do that. Because there are a lot of other poses that you're having them do in class when you're not saying, hey, don't forget to contract your psoas there. Hey, don't forget to contract your erector spinae there. So why are you asking them to do that there? Right? So this is a really good way to kind of take away, kind of take the veil away, kind of take, pull the curtain back and really start to understand what is behind a lot of those cues that you hear. So let's go on to the next video. I'm going to do one more example and then we'll wrap it up.